Welcome to Comics on a Pyre, a channel to have a meaningful conversation over movies, life, books, and shows, and maybe just a spot to spend time BSing over comics. If you like your entertainment with a bit of substance, then you, my vagabond friend, have come to the right tavern. Tether your horse by the post and come right on in and warm yourself by the fire. Tap that subscribe button, and for the next few minutes, my fellow George Carlin reprobate, lend me your ear. It's beautiful in its design, the melting down and molding of metal to create this, a reliable instrument of death. Its weight lays heavy in your hand, all that potential, giving anyone the ultimate power, the judgment over life and death. It's crazy, isn't it? I mean, I'm Daredevil for Christ's sakes. Hell's Kitchen, shining savior. It's beacon of hope. So why am I sitting here with you, Bullseye? My once greatest nemesis. Now an incapacitated vegetable. A shallow husk of the man that you once used to be. Well, the answer has something to do with this. It's a .38 caliber revolver, manufactured in Hartford, Connecticut, right here in the good old US of A. You know, Bullseye, this small piece of steel is one of the most popular handguns in America. And do you know why? It's not a target pistol, nor is it useful for hunting large or small animals, for its accuracy cannot be guaranteed for long distance shooting. No, this type of gun has been made and designed with one purpose in mind. There's only one reason that it's bought, stolen, and smuggled onto the island of Manhattan. And that one reason is to kill your fellow man, the most dangerous of game. Welcome, my fellow custodians, to another episode of Comics on a Pyre. Today, I will be going over a special issue that is near and dear to my heart. Daredevil issue number 191. This issue is special because it marks a seminal moment in Frank Miller's first run on A Man Without Fear. Here, Miller puts the finishing touches on his story arc by having Matt Murdock sit at Bullseye's bedside while he is laid up paralyzed in a hospital. In his monologue to his old enemy, Matt holds a gun to Bullseye's head and pulls the trigger. And then DD holds the gun to his own self as well and does the same, effectively going through all the bullet chambers of the gun until it gets to the very last chamber, playing out a game of death that many would know as Russian roulette. A sick game that only requires, as the comic book puts it, one bullet, one gun, and two idiots. Obviously, the game is more than that. As Matt explains, it is a metaphor for their relationship. You see, if you have read this run on Frank Miller's Daredevil, and I highly suggest that you do, you would know that DD has been through hell and back. Through this story arc, Daredevil has evolved, changed, and become more of the jagged-edged superhero that we know of today. He is no longer just a street-level crime fighter, goody-two-shoe good guy, but through Miller's storytelling, evolved into a deeply flawed character that questions his own moral compass. You see, in a very short recap, Matt, through Miller's story arc, falls in love with Elektra, a beautiful woman assassin. And even though their relationship was rocky, to say the least, he had hopes for her, for changing her, for the side of good. But Bullseye has other plans. In a breathtaking battle, Bullseye kills her, effectively driving Matt into a frenzy rage. The two fight, and Matt questionably kills Bullseye. But we find out later that he is not dead, but permanently paralyzed with a shattered spine, thereby leading eventually to this scene. You see, DD tells Bullseye that he questions who he has become. Over the course of time, Daredevil has changed. He feels it within. He has done things he would have never thought himself capable of back in the day before he met Bullseye and Elektra, before they ever came into his life. Things that he simply is not proud of. And what really drove this point home is discovering his effect on a little boy named Chucky. Having taken on a law case for the boy's father, Matt discovers his client's son's infatuation with the man without fear. The boy idolizes Daredevil to the point of believing that he is him. In doing so, the boy plays out a role of crime fighter himself. Through his actions, Chucky unintentionally sees his father beaten up by Daredevil, effectively throwing Chucky into a state of moral ambiguity. Does he still believe himself to be Daredevil, the crime fighter, even though he has seen him beat up his own father, the man that has raised him and shown him moral guidance, no matter how askew it was at times? This scene has after effects on Chucky, as later the boy brings a gun to school and shoots up the playground, effectively hurting another child, which leads to the question, was Chucky at the time of pulling the trigger playing out a fantasy as Daredevil, Bullseye, or even his father? Making Matt question the effect that he potentially has on the youth. Is he showing Chucky that might makes right? That all problems should be handled with violence at the bloody end of a fist? Which leads back to the hospital room with four corners, three windows, two men, and one gun between them. What happens at the end, I won't do you the disservice of spoiling it for you. But I will say this. If you are a Daredevil fan, you owe it to yourself to read this story, but I highly recommend starting at the beginning of Frank Miller's run to get the full impact of this one single issue. Well, that's it for now. In the meantime, check out my comic YouTube channel, Comics on the Pyre, for other videos like this one. Make sure to tap on that bell icon before you go. And oh yes, as always, until next time, keep reading, my friends.